This is open to all of us. We all can join this club. It's nothing to do with our training or our heritage or upbringing. We can be esteemers of God's name.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today.
Good morning, Steve. How are you today?
Good for this second run through.
Take two.
Take two. I hope my mouth catches up with my eyes and my brain. In James chapter 3, verses 9 and 10, the context is that James was talking about the power of the tongue. And this little piece of our body is like a rudder of a ship and like a bit that can control a horse, and it has great potential. And in this verse, he says, with it we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse people who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. And normally when I read that verse, I think, wow, I need to be careful. I need to be cautious what I say to people because I don't want to curse them. They're made in the image of God. But I sometimes miss the first part, which says, with it, we bless our Lord and Father. We have a wonderful opportunity as believers to bless God. And sometimes that thought just really reverberates in my heart. And I thought, wow, I'm alive. And one of my greatest privileges and opportunities is to, and I think of myself as this little insect, you might say, on the earth, looking up, and I can say, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. I can bless God. I can praise his name. And I noticed that three times in the Psalms, David says that when we die, we lose that opportunity. Psalm 6:5 says, in death there is no remembrance of you. In Sheol, who will give you praise? And in Psalm 30, verse 9, he says, what profit is there in my death if I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it tell of your faithfulness? And then Psalm 115 says, the dead do not praise the Lord, nor do any who go down into silence. And I would like to think that we have this opportunity and privilege while we're alive to praise God. So let's pray that God will help us to open our eyes to the potential of our tongues and our hearts to offer praise to God. Father, thank you for this truth. It's this amazing privilege and opportunity. And I don't know how to gauge it. I don't know how to measure the impact of it. But I do want to be a participant in it. I want to be one of those who praises your name while I have breath, while I'm on this earth, while I'm alive. I want to not be thinking so much of what you can give me, but that I can praise and bless your name. Help us to do that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So there's some more passages that encourage us along this line. Psalm 69 said, I will praise the name of God with a song. I will magnify him with thanksgiving. So these are two techniques, you might say. We can sing. I'm enjoying my hymn book more and more. I don't think I've ever systematically gone through it before, but I have it open on my computer. And in the morning now, I try to start by singing, obviously to myself, because my wife and son are still sleeping, and I go through a hymn. And I'm finding that that hymn carries through the day. Well, this morning I read one called Savior, Like a Shepherd Lead Us. You know that hymn? Savior, like a shepherd lead us.
I think I've heard it, but I don't know real well.
Well, it was sung at my wedding, and Sandy and I liked it. And as I read the history of the song, I found out that it was originally a Sunday school song. In fact, a lot of the hymns we sing today as adults were originally written as Sunday school songs. But Savior, like a shepherd, lead us, much we need thy tender care. And beautiful. But it's nice to sing praises to God. So that's one way. And the second way that he mentions there is to magnify him with thanksgiving. Isaiah 25 said, O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name, for you have done wonderful things, plans formed of old, faithful and sure. Hebrews 13:15 says, through him, then, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of lips that acknowledge his name. And then there's this longer passage. I hope that the listener don't stop just because I said longer, but it's three verses, and it's a magnificent passage from 1 Chronicles 29:11 through 13. I first ran across the first two verses when I was working through a book on financial principles from Scripture by Howard Dayton. Compass One Ministries is the name of it. And this is the verse that he used to acknowledge that God is Lord of all, that we are simply his stewards, that we don't owe anything, that he owns everything. But I'm going to read three verses. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in the heavens and in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. In your hand are power and might, and in your hand it is to make great and to give strength to all. And when we went through that course, I think it was an 8-week study, we had to memorize that. And then the 13th verse, though, this is 1 Chronicles 29:11-13. The 13th verse says, and now we thank you, our Lord, and praise your glorious name. Okay, so far, I've been, you might say, encouraging myself and our listeners that we will praise his name and use our opportunity while we have breath to praise God's name. Psalm 145 says, I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. What an ambition. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. That's the first three verses of Psalm 145. Now I'm going to put a little parenthetical passage in here. You know, you and I often go out to St. Louis and we meet with a bunch of kindred spirits in the winter. And many of us have thought of ourselves as Malachi men. And the reason we think of ourselves as Malachi men is because God has turned our hearts towards our families. What it says in the last couple of verses of Malachi, I'll turn the hearts of the fathers to children, etc. But here's a group of people, and I don't know, maybe we could call ourselves the Malachi people, but these people in Malachi 3:16 had a unique place, and they did something that was so wonderful that God took note, and he had their names written down. I'd like to be in this book. Here it is, Malachi 3:16. Then those who feared the Lord spoke with one another. The Lord paid attention and heard them. And a book of remembrance was written before him of those who feared the Lord and esteemed his name. Now, it's enough for us just to want to praise God for who he is. We're going to spend eternity doing that, and we're not going to run out of it's not going to be boring. We're going to continue to see new aspects of God's character and new things that he's done. We're going to see things that we've never seen them before, and we won't run out of things to give thanks and to praise to God. But wouldn't it be cool to be a part of that book? People who were known for fearing God and esteeming his name. And this is open to all of us. We all can join this club. It's nothing to do with our training or our heritage or upbringing. We can be esteemers of God's name. And we can be like the psalmist in Psalm 145 who says, every day I will bless you and praise your name. And I'm aspiring to this. I would like to make sure that every day I praise God and bless his name. Okay, so let's just not talk about it. Let's do it. Psalm 145, the rest of it, starting with the fourth verse. So this is giving you a little heads up, Scott. So let's see how many character qualities or worthy attributes we can discern from Psalm 145. So I'm going to read it, and I'm going to try not to stop, and maybe we can go back blow by blow. And if you have your computer on, you can pull it up, and you can look at it with me, which you probably already have.
I'm trying to cheat here.
Verse 4. One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts on the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works. I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power to make known to the children of man your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. I've never seen parentheses too much in the Bible, but here's some parentheses in Psalm 145. The Lord is faithful in all his words and kind in all his works. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand, you satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and kind in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desire of those who fear him. He also hears their cry and saves them. The Lord preserves all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth shall speak the praise of the Lord. And let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. All right, so let's go back and forth, see how long we can go here. Character quality of God from verses 4 to the end. What do you got?
Oh, mercy. I got lost just enjoying that. It seems like
mercy is one.
It seems like there was almost one or two at every verse.
I know it. This psalm is packed.
Yeah.
So pick one.
Let's see. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts, his mightiness, his might.
His might. Very good. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness. So he's abundantly good. Go ahead.
The glorious splendor of your majesty.
Good. He's gracious.
Righteousness.
He's merciful.
Compassionate.
He's good to all.
Slow to anger and rich in love.
There you go. We're doing well here. This is good. he's faithful in all his words.
There's might again, and they tell of the glory of your kingdom, so glorious.
Glorious. He's kind. Twice that word is used in here. Kind in all his works.
Trustworthy.
He upholds all who are falling. Well, I'll continue. And raises up all who are bowed down. So he takes care of us when we fall and are overwhelmed.
He provides. He says you give them food in their proper time.
Amen. He satisfies the desire of every living thing.
I like that one.
Yeah.
Let's see. Righteous in all his ways, faithful in all he does. We've talked on those already.
He's near to all who call on him.
Again, he fulfills the desires of those who fear him. He hears their cry and saves them. So he hears us and saves us.
Good. He preserves all who love him. I think that's the last one, but good job. And each one of those, if you just stop, and I keep, every time I think about if I had one attribute that has been a result of coming into his presence in the last couple of years, I would say kind, which is not what I would have thought before. I would have thought, you know, he's majestic and he's omnipotent and he's a savior and a redeemer and all these kind of things, all of which are valid. But in coming into his presence and sensing his presence, I keep finding out how patient and kind he is. And that was kind of unexpected, but it's wonderful. And that's one of the reasons I like that psalm, because twice it says he's kind, and he is. Okay.
Strange that we don't usually think of that. Like, when you think of God's attributes, kindness isn't usually one of the ones that pops to my mind anyway.
No.
I get the feeling people who hung out with Jesus felt that a lot, though, you know?
Yes. And that, I think that those people that had the opportunity to be with him, because he said some strong things to different ones, to Peter, to the apostles, but yet they knew him. So they knew he was kind, and they knew he was good, and they knew he was fair, and they didn't question those things. And so when Jesus said something, instead of being offended, saying, oh, you must be having a bad day or your hormones kicked in or something, they just said, no, this is coming to me in kindness. And they went with it. So
I have a little aside of encouragement here for anybody who wants to take up this as a idea or a challenge, because I thought of it for myself, but you know, those of us who know me well, know that I'm lazy enough that I probably won't do this, but maybe somebody will be good enough to decide to do this. I was just thinking, I spend way too much time just scrolling through my phone on social media. And I thought, man, and it stresses me out most of the time. Like, I don't really find any joy in it nowadays. And I'm thinking, as we're reading through this, I'm like, wow, I should replace that time with just reading a psalm. It would make a whole lot of difference, I imagine.
Well, I give you two. Psalm 145 and Psalm 103. I find God's goodness and his attributes sprinkled through those like no other psalms. And they do bless me. And you are right. The more we look around us, the more we're stirred up and stressed. And yet the more we look at him, the more we're calmed. Because he is God and he is in control, and he's good, and he doesn't sleep and he doesn't slumber. He's not overwhelmed with what's happening. And it's a different perspective. Amen. Well, Father, help us to take this to heart. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you for lips. Thank you for hearts. Thank you for revealing yourself to us more today than even yesterday. And I pray that these words which we heard this morning, you'll write them on our hearts and remind us to praise you and remind us to look to you. When everything around us is getting tough to look at, I thank you for you that don't change, and you're good and you're kind in all your works. In Jesus' name, amen.
And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email Steve at spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at Scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.